Z Sports Show. I am one of your hosts, Mr. Mark Adam, and I am all the way here in my basement at the, what do we call this again? The WP headquarters? I'm here and I am joined by my usual suspect friend, colleague, I don't even know what to call you anymore, Mr. Keith McKnight, socially distanced because he's coming all the way from COVID.
Oh, none of that.
So, thank you for joining us here on our episode of the LZ Sports Show. Before we get rolling and talk about how good the Jets are playing lately, in particular last night, I think maybe we should hear from our sponsor. We'll be right back after this.
Make your house a better place to come home to with Aquatech Pool, Spa, and Bath. We've been delivering complete customer satisfaction for over 40 years. Whether it's a fully completed backyard escape, a completely renovated bathroom, or a premium upgrade on outdoor furniture, Aquatech is the only name you need to know. That's because if it's an Aquatech job, it's an Aquatech team working on it. No outsourcing, no subcontractors. We do it all. Visit our one-of-a-kind showroom today at 1065 Dougald Road. Aquatech Pool, Spa, and Bath. We create better places to come home to.
We are happy to have you back here. Thank you very much to our sponsor, Aquatech Pool, Spa, and Bath. Greatly appreciate their support. And we are very excited to run you through what happened last night in Calgary. Why don't we go straight to the tape? First period, of course, we got a wonderful goal out of our power play. About, 8 seconds into that, Kyle Connor flips it forward, bounces off of Stastny, off of Wheeler, in the net it goes. Second period, early on in the second, by the way. We got a bad line change for Calgary, leaves Kyle Connor all on his own, gets two whacks at it, that's how much time he had. Not a good time for Calgary, obviously. And then Calgary trying to even things up. Hannifin rings one off the crossbar. No thank you, says Hellebuck. A little frustration there, obviously. Into the third period we go. Oh, look at this. Kyle Connor makes his own breakaway. Forget the bad change. He'll just make it happen. Gets poked at the last second. Loses the handle. 4 minutes later, right here, Lucic. Puck bounces off of him, off of Morrissey. It's in the back of the net. Calgary's on the board. A little unfortunate. Then Lucic takes a run at Appleton. Gets two for boarding here. And then Pionk comes to talk to him. On his way to the bench, Lucic punches Pionk and takes a double minor. Gets one for roughing, one for boarding. Calgary manages to kill off the first of those two double minors. But then Markstrom fired the puck over the glass, leading to a 5-on-3 situation. And Stastny buries one there. Rough day to be a Calgary Flame or a fan thereof.
It's the jerseys they wore last night. Those ones are just, they got to cut those out.
Yeah,
Death in those jerseys. Get those things out of there.
I hate those jerseys. Flames third. Oh, they're so ugly.
When the so Ottawa bad. Came back with their logo that they had in the 90s, I said, okay, this is a good turn of the tides for this team. That this is the start of the beginning of the end of all their failures now. So, yes. Yeah.
But you're also a man that subscribes to, you know, haircuts being a factor in games as well. So
yes, I am. Did you, Blake Wheeler cut his hair? Adam Lowry cut his hair? I was just like, what's going on here?
See, I knew you'd have some conspiracy theories regarding players, their hair, and their performance. But, I thought the Jets played a full 60 minutes again last night. They're putting together a lot of great hockey in a row. And Calgary takes their fourth loss in a row. Now a three-game winning streak for the Jets. This North Division is becoming the Jets' playground. It just is.
Yes,
let's look at the stats. The stats from last night's game, very, very favorable towards the Jets, of course. in all categories except for hits. They didn't really need to throw their weight around. They were dominating in puck possession, and their passing game was on point. A few more penalty minutes than we're used to seeing. Got a little playoff-y there, if you want to call it that. So, 2 for 6 on the power play for the Jets. That's great news. Their power play is, I think, what was it, running 40-something percent right now?
Yes, it was just over 40%, right?
Yeah, and then they went 33% last night alone. They're a team possessed right now. I don't want to be anybody in the North Division playing against the Jets. Honestly, the Jets right now, hottest team in the North. And they just slid back into the top 10 NHL-wide, so they're in the 10th spot in the NHL. But when you stacked up against your own division here, look at this. Winnipeg tied for first place with 44. They're losing in points percentage based on the fact that they've got one game in hand on Toronto. That one loss that Winnipeg has more than Toronto being the only difference. 21-10-2 for Toronto, 21-11-2 for the Winnipeg Jets. One extra game, one extra loss. But Winnipeg 6-3-1 in their last 10. Very exciting time to be a Jets fan. They are a very exciting team to watch, even when they lose. Those two games they lost against Edmonton, exciting games. They're games that even the fans were very excited about. What did you think of those?
I agree 100% as well. It had that playoff atmosphere, had that playoff intensity. It was just two very good teams going up against each other, right? And then look where the Jets are now. They rebounded themselves, and they're on top of Edmonton right now. So I don't think that that's something that the Jets felt threatened about. Of course, it hurt them a little bit. And, they're just like, okay, they took it very seriously. And I just can't even – I keep going back to that. Like, those two losses in Edmonton was, almost like what they needed.
It sort of added jet fuel to the fire, so to speak. So I really thought that those two games motivated them more than their wins did. Because they played so well in those games, they just didn't come out with the W's. So I think that frustration really, really just added to their motivation, as you said. So last night they played a really good game. Mason Appleton, by the way, after taking that boarding hit, seemed to be okay. I don't think there was any injury concern that I noticed. So hopefully that stays that way. I mean, when you look at the score sheet, only 5 players getting into the mix on both sides. 3 goals. Connor, Stastny, Wheeler each having multi-point nights. Shifley and Pullman, not to be denied. Pullman's first assist of the year, by the way.
Nice. There we go. We need him to start getting on the stat sheet in any way that he can.
Absolutely. And you got Hellebuck, 25 for 27 with a .926 save percentage last night. Markstrom, not so great. 26 for 29. Just under .900 error. Hannifin, I thought, played really well for the Calgary Flames. You know who I didn't think played well, even though there's a goal under his name, is Tkachuk. I really don't think he's not looking the same. The last few games Flames have
really toned it down a little bit.
Yeah, what's the deal there? Explain. What's happening with Tkachuk, do you think? He's you got this Tkachuk fandom going on. So tell me what's up with Tkachuk?
I don't know. Maybe he's probably toned. I think taking away from his feistiness, it's diminishing the amount of how much speculation. You're not hearing too much talk about him is what I'm going with either. He's not hitting the stat sheet very much, and it's just, I don't know why he's been so quiet. Do you think somebody, on the team told him to, tone down, him? I know you call him a pest. Do you think somebody talked to him about that?
I'm hoping, because, I'm saying pest because I'm trying to keep the show family-friendly. What I really think about his play is it involves a lot of words I don't want to get into right now. So pest was the nicest way that I could say he's a monster jerk. And that style of play, it gets you just so far. And for talented players like Tkachuk, I almost said Keith Tkachuk, oof, shake that off. Talented players like him, and a guy that I think is more talented that still plays that pest style that really doesn't need to, drives me insane, Brad Marchand. That,
oh, yes.
That guy,
thing.
He is such a pest. He's just an, he's a jerk of a human being to everyone all the time. And he's so talented. He could be the Sidney Crosby level player if he stopped being an absolute jerk and just played the game. And I think Tkachuk, if he shook that being a pest, he got a goal tonight. Quietly did it in nice style. I mean, the rest of the Calgary game needs a lot of work. The bad line change. Calgary had a, you know, every time Calgary made a mistake, the Jets were on top of them, and three separate times they made them pay. You know, Markstrom goofs up, flings that puck over the glass, ends up giving away the 5-on-3 after they managed to kill off the first of the double minor penalties that Lucic was in the box for. So then the Jets end up getting that third goal, which ends up being the winner based on mistakes that Calgary was making. And the Jets just weren't making those kinds of mistakes last night. And that is a relieving thing to see based on how many mistakes the Jets were making that were giving away games before. You know, now we're getting back up. We're 6-3-1 in the last 10 instead of, what was it, 5-4-1. Like, and it was looking rough there for a bit for the Jets. They were trending the wrong way, and now they're on the way back up, because I think those, like we said before, those two losses to Edmonton really shook them. But I don't know, getting that kind of play out of a player that has such potential. I hate watching Tkachuk play. He's too good a player to be doing some of the things he's doing. And Lucic is another goon that isn't quite as skilled. Like, he's more of a goon first, hockey second. And there's been players like Bertuzzi. Like, there's players that have their place, right? Guys who are tough guys. They're there to knock bodies around, loosen up pucks, and make you think twice about going into the corner with that pace. You know, those players have a place in the game. But that style of play is very, very far from what Tkachuk is, which is, he's a fast, skilled player that's just annoying. He's just irritating. He just aggravates people. Whereas Lucic intimidates people by his presence. He's a big guy. I mean, look at his nose. You think that's been broken once or twice? God. Yeah, right? That guy's taken a couple of punches. I'm just saying, they're two very different things. So I'm not a big fan of the way Lucic plays, but I respect the way Lucic plays. You know, I hate playing against Lucic, but I respect Lucic.
Seeing his name on the roster is something that...
Yeah, I don't like seeing players like Tkachuk. I hate the way that they play. Like, the Sean Avery era is over. Get off the ice. Go away. Like, there's no room for you here. You know? So, anyway, that's my thoughts on that. Let's pick our Jets. Who'd you pick as a Jet that stood out for you last night?
Number 25, Paul Stastny.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Tell me why.
He was highly involved with just about everybody on the team. He got the boys really. He keeps the guys going, is what I've noticed. If there's anybody who's always got some jump in their step, it's always Paul Stastny. And you can see here, as he brought up the highlight he is, like, you put the right spot, and then nobody knows what to do with him, because there's so many other people on the ice there that will be, if the puck is on their stick, they're going to be a threat to that goalie and that defense support. And you saw that right here on the power play. Like, they're just lost, and boom, he's just literally, like, look, he just stood there, and he didn't move. He maybe moved like 180 degrees or 360 at the entire time when he was standing there, and then boom.
Yeah, Mr. Stastny. That guy, man, he's so good, eh?
He is. And who was your Jet of the night last night?
For me, I got to go with Neil Pionk.
Okay.
I think Neil Pionk was everything to the Jets again last night. Didn't make it onto the score sheet, but he was a guy that when you needed him to be good with a stick, with a hit, with you know, just being in the right place, he was there. So I'm having an issue here with our video. Let's jump back into that. Pionk, show me the Pionk. There we go. Nice stick, right? Gets in the way. hits the puck out of danger, you know, spins around the net, has a look, very smart, quick. Just look at the stick here in the third period, takes away that. Unfortunately, this play ends up being a goal 2 seconds later anyway, but by no fault of Pionk, Pionk has done everything here that he can do, you know? It's a frustrating situation when you're Pionk, when you're playing that well and that kind of stuff happens to you, and you just see his face here at the end of this clip, just not happy. You know, he did everything in his power to make that not a goal, and they end up scoring on that anyway. Mind you, power play goal. I thought the Jets' penalty kill was super great over the last couple of games, and I'm really happy with the way that they are playing. But I just thought Pionk was the right kind of everywhere. When he destroyed Gaudreau in the corner there, that was amazing. That made me so happy. He just like blew him up. And Gaudreau had no idea where he was for a second. It was great, you know. So that's my player of the game for sure. Looking at those that score sheet, you can't get away from how good Wheeler and Scheifele and Stastny that line is. I know for me, the second line is the first line. But since I said that on this show, Stastny, Wheeler, and Scheifele have been putting up numbers. And it's almost, and I say this every show, it's almost like they're listening to us. And they're like, wait a minute, no thank you. And, you know, they turn that stat around. So a very, very exciting time to be a Jets fan. So now the Jets look forward to playing two more in Calgary. Tonight, another 9 o'clock start, and then Monday, another 9 o'clock start as well.
I know. It's like, if we're talking about the past game, it's almost like it's all in the future because it's a back-to-back and like they're playing tonight. It's crazy. It's just absolutely nuts.
Another little statistic from last night, 22 block shots for the Jets. They have been blocking machines for the last couple of games. That's been great. The Flames only 9 block shots, and the Jets kept a team under 30 shots again, which is nice, and outshot the Flames. That's something we don't see a lot of this year, but that will be a recipe for success going closer to the playoffs. And if you're not out shooting other teams in the playoffs, you're just not going to win playoff games. So it's nice to see that they can outshoot teams from time to time. Hopefully that's a thing that they can focus on moving towards the end of this regular season.
Yes, exactly.
So, again, top 10 in the NHL, 10th place if you look at points percentage, 9th if you look at raw points, 18 goals to the plus in the goal differential category. What else is there to say? 11-6-1 on the road, 10-5-1 at home. So they have more road wins than home wins, but that also comes out of the fact that of the 17 games they played in March, 12 of those were on the road.
Yeah, it's a busy month away, right?
Right. Well, sorry, 17 games in March. They haven't played all 12 of their road games in March yet, but 13 of their last 15 games have been on the road.
On the road, yeah, there it is.
I think. I may be messing that stat up. It doesn't matter. The point is, they're very impressive no matter whose arena they're playing in. So I'm very happy. And my favorite number to see with them right now is the big old W3 in the streak category. Three wins in a row.
Love. They had a season high of 4, right? So hopefully they can capitalize on that, right, Mark?
I mean, why not, right? You got 2 more games against a struggling Calgary team. Now, the problem there is that Calgary is on, that's their 4th loss last night. They have 2 games left to play against the Winnipeg Jets. It's hard to say that the Jets are going to beat them 3 out of 3. You predicted that they would, which I love. That was your bold prediction. You said 3, and not only did you say 3 wins, you said 3 regulation wins. That was your big bold prediction. So yeah. I really like that. But, you know, Calgary with 4 losses in a row now, they are going to come out desperate in the next 2 games. If they don't win tonight, Monday night's game is going to be an absolute brawl. I feel when the desperation sets in for teams like Calgary and teams like Toronto, they pull out all the stops. And
the only thing,
go ahead. Oh, sorry.
No, yeah, I was just going to say the only thing that the Jets need to make sure that they don't forget in Calgary are the 6 points they need to bring back home here to Winnipeg, and I don't think they will forget that.
Well, four now. They've already took two.
Two, right? Yeah, there you go. Exactly.
And that's what's wonderful about the Jets. That's done. That's in the past. Take it out of the equation. What we need now is, and the answer is, 4 points out of Calgary in the next 3 days. So tonight, 3 days. Monday, you know, they get a day off tomorrow after the most insane March. And next month, it's the same thing. There's one break where they get 3 days off. Every other break is 1 day or no break. It's literally back-to-back or one day off all month for the Winnipeg Jets. And the Vancouver Canucks, after the Jets played them there the other night, they get to sit and they're waiting for us to wear Calgary down so that Calgary plays a well-rested Vancouver Canucks squad at the end of the month. I'm excited to see how the rest of the series plays out. I think if Tkachuk continues to be a non-factor, and I say that knowing he scored a goal last night, but he is not playing the disruptive type of game that he is like known for and used to playing. And while I think long-term that's good for the Flames, because if he gets playing actual hockey and just actual hockey, I think that's a great thing for the Flames. I think in the short term, there's things that Calgary's going to need to do to adjust to make up for the absence of that sort of disrupted opponent. They're going to have to do other things to get under the skin of whoever it is that they're playing. So we'll see what they do in the next two games against the Jets, but it's going to be a struggle going forward.
A huge struggle going forward, especially coming against this Winnipeg Jets team. And when you have the Jets, who's probably going to demoralize you in these next two games, how do you rebound from that? Because just about everybody in this division is really good.
Yeah, just about. We 6 of 7 solid teams, you know? Mm-hmm. You know, I think, because if Calgary turns it around, they can still make the playoffs. If Vancouver figures it out, they can still make the playoffs.
They can sneak in there, because Vancouver, up until those losses against the Jets, you were showing the fans that they had a really good last 10 record. And other than they were doing super well. Then the Jets show up and like, forget you guys.
Yeah, the Jets sort of cut their legs out from under them. But again, I'm bringing this stat up again. Just look at the last 10, because Vancouver 6-3-1 in their last 10. That's not terrible. And remember, two of those were losses to Winnipeg, in which Vancouver played very well. Vancouver's two losses to Winnipeg, you know, from a Vancouver standpoint, had to have felt very much like the two losses that Winnipeg suffered to Edmonton, where you played really well, but you got nothing out of it. And as I said last time, it's unfortunate for Vancouver that they get this big, long 7-day break after having lost two games like that. That's a rough way to go into a nice off pause, because they take that sort of downward energy instead of they were riding high prior. They were 7-2-1 prior to running into Winnipeg, and they tanked the end of their run there. So now they're going to be coming out hopefully rested and hungry, and not rested and sad, because sadness leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to the dark side. So, I forget what movie that's from. No, I'm not kidding. It's, you know, Yoda's a hero of mine. But, you know, there's so many ways to look at how the playoffs are shaping up in general. I'm excited to see what the Jets do, because they're turning on at the right time. You talk about streaks, up, down, slumps, this, that. You never want to be slumping towards the end of a season. You don't want to back your way into the playoffs. And the Jets, they slumped a little bit in the middle of the season. And in a short season, that's good, because now they're on their way up. And with the Jets having already played 34 games, there's only 22 games left.
So only 22. It's going to go by quick.
It is going to go by in a hurry. 56-game season is short, and every single point matters that much more. I'm very happy to see their big old plus 18 in the goal differential because, as I mentioned, all the teams currently sitting in a playoff position are in the plus. All the teams out of playoffs in the North Division are negative in the goal differential category. And there's, I think there's a direct correlation. If you're not scoring enough goals, you're literally just not going to win. That's just how it works. And there was an analyst I saw on I can't remember if it was one of the big networks, but he said teams that outscore their opponents generally make the playoffs. And I thought that makes a lot of sense. Like that made a lot of sense to me. I don't know. it's kind of a, yeah, that makes, that's how the math works. Yeah. So, but just to put that in perspective, the Jets just goals for 112 so far in their 34 games played. Calgary 35 games played, only scoring 91 goals. But they've allowed over 100, right? So 91 goals scored isn't going to cut it. Like, you're just not going to – that doesn't cut the mustard, as they say. Montreal barely – they're literally 100 goals exactly right now, goals for. So that is – that's something to watch is, you know, the Winnipeg, when they score three goals or more, are – I think they got one loss on the year. When they score four goals or more, are undefeated. And they keep scoring four goals or more. It's happened a whole bunch of times. So, I don't know. I'm very happy with how the Jets are playing. I'm happy with where they sit in the division. I'm happy with where they sit in the league. And what do you think their chances are when they get to the playoffs? Do you think that, do we have the depth to go seven straight games against the same team over and over again? Or is that not a strength of ours? What do you think?
That is a strength. The Jets have the capacity to, and the strength to go all the way to seven games. But my question is for the other teams is that, do they have what it takes to play the Jets for five games? Because the Jets are a hungry team and they're finally coming together, and they are, I'm not, like I said, I compare those two losses against Edmonton, like how Corey Perry felt when the Stars lost that one game and he sat on the bench, that something's going on with this team right now. And I'm 100% right behind them. I don't see very many teams in the playoffs taking the Jets past 5 to 6 games. I don't see any of their series going to seven. I don't. JP Vigée said the two things that you learn about when you play in a game seven is that, you know, wow, this is my first game seven. I don't ever want to ever be back here ever again. So you realize that, okay, this is not someplace I ever want to be, but you only can learn that by playing in your first game seven. So hopefully the Jets don't put themselves in that situation.
And it's not like there's no experience in the Jets locker room as far as playoffs are concerned. Blake Wheeler, Shifley, like these guys, they've been there. They've played. They haven't had a ton of success. What I really like is now they got Lewis on the team. That guy, he's got two cups already, you know, with the LA Kings. So I think they're doing what they got to do. Now, to that point, the league has just made a deal. They've worked something out with the Canadian federal government to allow for a 7-day quarantine, which is opening up trade opportunities for, you know, Canada to trade with the U.S. What do you think, first of all, question one, what do you think of the Canadians picking up Stall out of Buffalo? Because that, like, let's talk details of that trade in a second. And the second question will be, do you think the Jets need to go get Ekholm or someone to help out on that defensive end, or do they ride it out with who they got? So let's start with the trade that happened. Go.
Really happy for Jordan Stall. Big fan of all the Stall brothers. Before I can tell you this, I'm just going to share something quickly about the Stall brothers. So started getting back into hockey cards the last couple of years, and, you know, I thought there was only three Stahl brothers. Got all three Stahl brothers, and I was like, oh, man, this is so cool. Oh, this is so great. I got, like, the Stahl brothers, all three of their cards. This is so awesome. Then I go on Wikipedia, and I find out the fourth Stahl brother. Like, great, great, great. That accomplishment just way out the window. But it's nice to see him get out of an environment where, I don't know, I don't like to bash on teams, but just things aren't really working out very well in Buffalo. And I had a chance to speak with one of their fans, and he said that goaltending has always been their biggest problem. So You know, getting Staal out of there, I'm sure he's happy with it. I'm sure he must have been talking with his agent quite a bit to get out of Buffalo, because he's a high star caliber player, right? You know, coming in from Minnesota, and he has high success, and yeah.
Point of order, I think you said Jordan Staal, but it was Eric Staal that was traded.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, see what I mean? See, that's exactly right.
There's four of them. It's hard to keep track.
Forgiveness there. Thank you for the pardon.
it's hard, because even I always have to look and go, wait, which Staal was that? And all of them are good. And it's funny, because the first three Staals made the NHL, right? The first three. And then they were all talking about how their brother was the best of all four of them. And he wasn't even in the NHL yet at that time. He was like 16.
Nope.
So yeah. it was crazy. And all the Staal brothers are very talented at whatever they do, whether they play forward, whether they play defense. It literally doesn't matter where on the ice they are. They're probably going to be one of the better players in that position. And I think that is the sign. Buffalo is, they're selling off everything. They're liquidating.
They're done.
And they know that. Have they won a game in the month of March yet? Let me 2 seconds. I'm gonna scroll down.
Staal is gonna sign in Winnipeg next year out of free agency. Just watch.
No, they still have yet to win. They're 0-9-1 in their last 10. but it's worse than that. Because they haven't won a game since February 23rd or something like that. So it's a bad time to be on the Buffalo Sabres squad. So everyone is going to be wanting out, and you know, they're rocking a 0.250 points percentage. Eek. Absolutely the worst in the league. Detroit is trying to catch them. Anaheim is working on it real hard, but they just can't underperform the Buffalo Sabres. And I think with that, so a bunch of things went into that trade too. You got to remember, the Buffalo Sabres have to keep a bunch of his, like half of his contract dollars. They have to pay the rest of his contract out for the rest of the year or whatever it is, like half of it. And they gave away, or they only got two picks for him. The Montreal Canadiens don't give up a single player. They give up a third and a fifth round pick. They only have to pay him half his salary for the rest of the year, and then they can sign him to whatever they want next year or get rid of him. It costs them nothing. There is, aside from the 7-day quarantine, there is no downside for the Habs right now on that trade. That is an amazing, that was a giveaway deal. So,
for sure. To the Jets, I think that, no, they don't need anybody. They don't.
Nope.
They don't mess up this chemistry now, because Pierre-Luc Dubois was a big trade enough already, and they timed that out perfectly. It was early, and it was just like, wait, like, boom, let's get this done right now. So here we go.
Yeah, but that also followed trade rumors that went like most of the off season about Line A wanting to be traded. Does he want to be traded? And you know, that followed there was a lot of media lead up to that prior to that trade happening. And
yeah.
I think this is a different situation where now, do the Jets want to make a run for the cup? If so, obviously everybody wants to make a run, but does Cheveldayoff need to go buy some outside help to make a run viable? And your answer, too long didn't read, TLDR, no. The Jets have all the pieces they need?
Have it.
I love that. I love the confidence you have in that. I'm less certain, but I really do think that this team has a ton of potential. Whether they go for that trade or not, I will probably think it's the right thing. You know, in Cheveldayoff we trust.
Yes.
You know, he continually proves through media scrutiny and whatever else happens, he's continually proving that his maneuvers are the best thing for the team.
Yes.
Always. That Kane trade, the Trouba trade, and we're using the players' names who left to mark those, because there were things at the time that were, do you agree or disagree? But they've turned out to be very good things for the Winnipeg Jets in the long term. And I mean, look no further than Neil Pionk. He was my player of the game this last night. You know, for me, he's the best player on the ice for the Jets last night.
Yeah.
Truba who? More like Huba? Anyway,
Huba.
Too many puns. But the point is, Pionk is every bit that player, and Sheveldayoff knew that somehow. And so if he goes to get Ekholm, sacrificing, potentially giving up somebody like Sandberg and another pick or something like that, and then potentially exposing someone to the draft, the expansion draft with Seattle, like a Logan Stanley, if he does that, I believe he believes it's the right thing to do for the squad. But if he chooses to go with the guns he's got, I really think that they have enough firepower to make it happen. So I'm on the fence over whether or not we need to go get someone, but that's a personal opinion. Was there anything else you wanted to add today? Was there any other little thing going on for you?
No, I think that was it. We talked about just about everything we needed to, you know, just remind the fans, you know, it's a back-to-back. So, like I said, it sounds like it's in the past, but it's all in the future because it's the same thing today. You know, the Jets just got to go back in there and win. So, at 9 o'clock puck drop tonight. And yep.
Not a lot of movement in the league last night either, by the way. Just the Edmonton-Montreal game was postponed. So, there's still COVID-related concerns in Montreal at the moment, which is not ideal, obviously. But I think hopefully, you know, they've got those players quarantined. They're doing everything that they can to make sure everybody's as safe as possible. Hopefully that return to play happens soon. Those games get made up. Wouldn't it be great if Vancouver had some games postponed at some point? Because they got a week off. They got all this time to make up these games. Travel around the country just playing people on their off nights. It's like, hey, you got a night off. You want to play a game? It's like a pickup hockey style thing. I don't know. It's a weird season this year. But I really enjoy it. The way hockey is playing, that playoff style atmosphere, the more you play a team, the more you hate that team, and these Canadian rivalries that are being reignited. I love it. I love that we get to see. And by the way, Battle of Alberta, Calgary, Edmonton. How about the Battle of Atlanta? The two teams that came out of Atlanta, the Atlanta Flames to Calgary, and the Winnipeg Jets all the way from the Atlanta Thrashers, right? The two teams that moved out of Atlanta going head-to-head for the next couple of days. I think that's great. Forget the Battle of Alberta. It's all about the Battle of Atlanta.
There it is.
So if you're an Atlantian? That's Atlantis. Atlantian hockey fan? Who are you cheering for? I want to know. Are you a Jets supporter or a Flames supporter? Or do you hate both of them for leaving? Who do you got? I want to know. Hit us up in the comments. Do follow us on all the social medias, by the way. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, all of that. We would greatly appreciate your support on that matter. If you do hit us up on the social medias, like and subscribe. That goes a long way for us. I know it doesn't mean a lot to you, but it's huge for us. Also, do give us a call. If you want to voice your opinion, we want to hear your opinion. Give us a call. The number is 431-800-4555. Leave us a message. We'll use those voice messages on future episodes of this show. If you're not a talker, but you're a typer, then you can always email us, thelz@thewpg.ca. You can comment below on this video on YouTube. You can comment below this video on the WPG.ca on the website if you're watching it there. If you're on Reddit, comment on the Reddit thread. Wherever you want to comment, we want to hear from you. So let us know what your thoughts are on the Jets, their playoff hopes this season. It doesn't even have to be Jets. This is the LZ Sports Show, so when the Bombers start playing, when the Valor FC are back in action, we want to be talking about all these Winnipeg clubs. What do you care about? We want to talk about it. Let us know. And we will see you next time. Thanks again to our wonderful sponsor, Aquatech Pool Spa and Bath. They are great. We appreciate all the support we can possibly get. And they are just, it goes a long way for me, to be honest. So for myself, I am Mark Adam. for this guy over what side is he on? This side? Yeah, he's on that side. I get confused with the camera. But yeah, for myself, Mark Adam, for Keith McKnight, this is the LZ Sports Show. We will see you next time in the LZ.